Testing, 1, 2, 3, testing.
This morning, in that song, Thanksgiving, praise to God, and I'm glad to be here today. Good to see you in the Lord's house. It really is. Thank you, Reverend Howard. Thank you, Deacon Nelson. Thank you, Timothy. And thank you, Ruth. Amen. And I'd like to thank all of those who are back with us this morning. We praise God for you today. I want this to be a very, very special message today, and I pray that God will take the Word of God and apply it to our individual hearts. And it is my prayer that this message this morning will remain with you for the rest of your days. For from the book of Ruth, we read this morning, and we kind of started the story and ended the story in chapter 1. So if you really want to know the intricate details of the book of Ruth, you have to read chapters 2, 3, and especially chapter 4, because that's where the nitty-gritty information is found in the book of Ruth. Otherwise, why study Ruth? There's more about this woman, history for us at this point, but not really just simply history. It's a legacy for us. Because what I want to impress upon our hearts here today is the fact that Jesus Christ is Lord of all, and that he is a kingdom man. You see, God has been establishing his kingdom. And when you read in the Old Testament, and when we deal with what we're going to look at here this morning, we have to recognize the fact that God is about kingdom building. That's what he's about. It's always been that way. We read in the text this morning, I would like for you to note, beginning at chapter 1, and let's pick it up at verse 19, and then I'm going over to chapter 4, and pick it up beginning at verse 9, and hopefully try to tie these together this morning in this message where we are talking about God is establishing his kingdom. And this is the only kingdom that one can tie into if he's going to experience eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The story was told of a rock star who rented an entire hotel. He just went into town. This is a major city in our country. And he rented one of the most precious hotels in the city, bought it for a week, put his people in there. And this individual, this was a true story, said that he went to go up to his 13th floor, and they said, no, you can't go up there because this star has rented the entire hotel. Well, he had a room, and so sure enough, they allowed him to go up to the 13th floor. To the floor where he was. The rock star was on the elevator. And he said to the rock star, I know you're a big man. You got a lot. But I want you to know that God wants every man to bend and bow to the Lord Jesus Christ. And this star looked at him and said, who, me? I don't bow to anybody. I am, and he gave his name. I don't bow down to anybody. Do you know who you're talking to? And so he went on to witness to the man to tell him that one of these days you will, of necessity, bend and bow to the Lord Jesus Christ. God is establishing his kingdom this morning, and Ruth is dealing with the kingdom of God. And I would like for you to read with me, and I thank you for bringing your Bible to church. Excuse me. Boy, it's an important and vital part of our worship. Ruth 1, beginning at verse 19. Now the two of them went until they came to Bethlehem, and it happened when they had come to Bethlehem that all the city was excited because of them, and the women said, "Is this Naomi?" But she said to them, "Do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has afflicted me?" So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, who returned from the country of Moab. Now they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley harvest. Pick it up, if you will, in chapter 4. And let's go down to, I'd like to start at verse 7. Now this was the custom in former times, in the book of Ruth, I'm sorry, chapter 4 now, verse 7. Now this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging. To confirm anything, one man took off his sandal and gave it to the other, and this was a confirmation in Israel. Therefore, the close relative said to Boaz, "But buy it for yourself," so that he took off his sandal. And Boaz said to the elders and to all the people, "You are witness this day that I have bought all that Elimelech and all that Chilion and Mahlon from the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the widow of Mahlon, I have acquired as my wife, to perpetuate the name of the dead through his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brethren and from his position at the gate. You are witnesses this day." Verse 13. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And when he went in to her, the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Then the women said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord, who has not left you this day without a close relative, and may his name be famous in Israel. And may he be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you, who is better to you than seven sons, has borne him." Then Naomi took the child and laid him in her bosom and became a nurse to him. Also the neighbor women gave him a name, saying, "There is a son born to Naomi," and they called his name Obed. He is the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now this is the generation of Perez. Perez begat Hezron. Hezron begat Ram. And Ram begat Amminadab. And Amminadab begat Nahshon. And Nahshon begat Salmon. Salmon begat Boaz, and Boaz begat Obed. Obed begat Jesse, and Jesse begat David. God's wonderful effort. to establish the throne of David forever and forever. And so would you bow with me as I'm going to address you this morning from the basic subject of the God's King upon his throne. God has set his King upon his throne. And in order to know the Lord Jesus Christ, we have to come through the Lord Jesus and accept him. Father, I pray that you would bless your word to our hearts this morning. Teach us, Lord, out of your word, the fact that unless we come to Jesus, this son born to Boaz and Ruth, and this elder son, who is none other than Jesus Christ, as we see in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 6. Speak to our hearts. Let us know, Lord, that there are many gods out there. There are many kingdoms. There are many people to whom others bow down and worship, but none like this King whom you have put on your throne, and may he teach us this morning out of your word. We thank you, and we'll give you praise, but we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, the book of Ruth is one that I offer to each one of us because it carries with it the power of this divinic kingship that God promised in Genesis 3:15. See, God said back there that the seed of the woman would somehow bruise the head of the serpent, and that the head of the serpent would strike the heel of the woman. And Jesus Christ was that prophecy that was being fulfilled at that particular juncture. Now, look, if you will, in Ruth chapter 1. I won't go into a lot of detail, but I want us to see here that David is God's king. And God was trying to establish kingship in Israel. You read the book of 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel. You read the books of the kings. What is God doing? What is he up to? God is establishing a king. And most of us know that in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 22, you probably know it from heart, but I'm coming back to the book of Ruth. Go back to 1 Samuel chapter 15, and I want you to notice verse 22. The first king selected, his name was Saul. And Saul was a big man. Anybody in his right mind would have feared Saul because he was strong. He was a warrior. He was brave. And look at what God says concerning Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 22. So Samuel said, "Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you from being king." And he says, "Saul, I put you up as one of my kings. I let you give the leadership to people. But because you have rebelled against me, and because you have rejected me, I want you to know that I don't like stubbornness. I don't like rebellion. I have to take you down. And so what happened to Saul? We know. We were in Beth Shean not long ago, and they have a stake upon the mountain, and which is kind of a demonstration of what the Philistines did to Saul. They eventually killed him. They took him up on the mountain. They killed Saul and his son, Jonathan. They took him up on the mountain, and you read about this in 2 Samuel chapter 1. And they killed him, and they hung him up on the pole, high mountain in Beth Shean, and everybody who came by saw the tragedy of this king of Israel impaled on a stake. He was a failure. Well, Saul was followed by, God said, I've sought a man after my own heart. And what was his name? David. Said, I'm going to put David in office because David is a good young man. But you read in 2 Samuel chapter 11 how David miserably failed. This is the man whom God said, there's not been a king like David. He is the pattern for all of the kings. But David did something that was unconscionable, okay? 2 Samuel, look at chapter 11. 2 Samuel, chapter 11. And this is what we read concerning this great man called David. So we're looking to a greater king than just David. That's a point this morning. 2 Samuel, chapter 11, and verse 1, it says, and it happened in the spring of the year, at the time when kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab, his servants, with him, and all Israel, and they destroyed the people of Ammon and besieged Rabbath, but David remained at Jerusalem. Then it happened one evening that David arose from his bed and walked on the roof of the king's house. And from the roof, he saw a woman bathing. And the woman was very beautiful to behold. Now you think David went out saying, hey, I would really want to get into some trouble today. But he should have known better. His men are out there fighting in Ammon. And I wish I could show you the spot. I wish I could show you that. The huge mountain that Ammon's place was on. And David was saying to his soldiers, go conquer Ammon. And when David looked and saw that beautiful woman out there bathing herself, what did he do? He said to his servant, Joab, hey, go tell that woman I want her to come to my house. Joab said, well, don't you know it's a married woman? I mean, she's got a husband. David said, well, listen, I am the king, after all, and I asked for you to go get her. And so Joab sent the message, went in, and David went in unto Bathsheba. Bathsheba was on the roof of her house taking a bath. David was upon the roof of his house just kind of, you know, spending time. He should have been out there in the field. You don't have to go to seek to find how you can sin and fall short of the glory of God. Some of the best intentions are strewn with immorality and sin. And this is one of the great sins that we are wrestling with today. We talk about crime and abortion and all of the other problems that we are dealing with in our world today. Well, it didn't just come about today. It's been going on for a long, long time. And David went in unto Bathsheba. And Bathsheba, of course, sent that note to him, probably saying, I think I'm pregnant. And David said, oh, my goodness. How can I get out of this one? So his human reasoning went into play. And And so he said, well, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll just cover this over. You have to read Psalms 32 and Psalms 51 to see why God said David is a man after my own heart. Because once the prophet pointed his finger at David and said, look, you did this dirty, dastardly deed. You, the king, sent one of your chosen men into battle and sent a note by him saying, set you Uriah in the front of the line and retire back from him because I want him dead. But before he got there, he said, well, give Uriah a break. Let him go home to his wife. And I'm going to cover up this sin. Nobody will know about it once he goes home to his wife from the war zone. But God spoke to Uriah, and God said, Uriah said, how could I go in unto my wife when my men are out there in the front of the line being killed as we fight for our king, our leader? And the tragedy is that this man, David, failed miserably. Don't ever think, amen, that we're so strong that we can come up against the temptation and the sin and the things that will be thrown at us. And David failed miserably because Uriah didn't go home. He slept outside that night. And David saw him outside the next day. Why didn't you go in unto your wife? No, I can't do that. Then he writes the note to Joab. He said, Joab, I've got to cover this up some way. I tried one thing, that failed. You know, human reasoning, amen, won't get us there. It's following the will of God. It's obeying the Lord Jesus Christ. That will always bring us victory. But when we lean to our own understanding, what do we expect? You see. And so the note was given to Uriah, sealed. He went back and told the commander-in-chief, set ye Uriah in the front of the line and retire from him because I want him dead. He said, I can't believe David did that. Yes, he did it. Let me tell you something. When the evil one breaks loose in a man's heart, there's nothing too bad for him to do. We think about Hitler and all of the tragic things that he did to kill people. And there's a little bit of germ of Hitler in every man. It's called sin. I'm not saying that we've done what Hitler did, but it's that same principle that the evil one will always pick at because he does not want you to have victory over sin. He wants you living beneath the privileges that God has called you to live as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. And unless we yield to the Lord Jesus Christ, read our Bible daily, meditate on the word of God. Pray. Do in obedience to what God has spoken in his word. Unless we do that continuously, we will always succumb to the attacks of the evil one. My heart was really thrilled as I read where when Jesus Christ was baptized, remember, he went down into the water and he came up out of the water. And then there was a voice of God that spoke. And the voice of God said this, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. And when God announced who Jesus was, otherwise Satan didn't know who he was. He was just a boy in Nazareth. He was just a young man, just like any other young man. But when the Holy Spirit of God descended upon him and the voice of God said, this is my beloved son, Satan caught the message. Now this is the one that I need to tempt. And from that point, he drove him into the wilderness and for 40 days and 40 nights, Jesus Christ was tempted. And he was victorious over every temptation that was thrown at him. I want to tell you something. When you get involved in living for the Lord Jesus Christ and worshiping him and obeying him and seeking to please the Lord Jesus, the evil one cannot touch you because he is a created being. Satan is not God. Satan doesn't know everything that's happening. But Jesus is the only one who was not created, who is divine. He knows everything. And I said, Lord, help me to obey you. Help me not to count lightly the injunctions that you have given to me in the Word of God. May I follow them as you have promised in your Word to give me victory if I do. So David, what happened to David? Failed miserably. After that sin of Bathsheba, I mean, David's house just went to kaputs. He was downhill from that point on. Never regained where he was. His son Amnon raped his sister. And ultimately, his son Absalom drove him from the throne. Went in unto the concubines that David had, him humiliated him and embarrassed him. And there were others who attacked David. You see, sin will always take you down. Now the evil one is going to say, it's not going to bother you. You know, you can handle this. No, you can't handle it. The only one who can handle it is Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. And if you obey him, he will give you victory. So God's been trying to establish his kingdom. David failed miserably. There's no man, it seems to me, in all of the scriptures who failed as much as David did. And yet, God said, he's a man after my own heart. God will forgive you. God will cleanse you if you will genuinely come to him and confess your sin. And it's unfortunate that God says, I'll forgive you, I'll cleanse you. But there is a requirement. You have to acknowledge your wrong deeds. You have to ask me to forgive you. And of course, David, with a broken heart, cries out in Psalms 32 and Psalms 51, God, I did this against you. Not only did I have a man killed, not only did I go in unto another man's wife and commit adultery, but I also had a man killed. And I broke all of the laws. God, you see right through me. God, you know me. You know who I am. And David pleaded to God for forgiveness. And of course, God lifted the burden. But God never put him back where he was. He was downhill from that point on. And so we're looking for a king who is going to sit upon the throne of David, who's going to be a perfect king. And we're talking about the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ today. There's another king, Solomon, of course, and we know what happened to him. You go to 1 Kings chapter 11, and Solomon went after strange women. And every woman he saw, he wanted. Consequently, the Bible has this strange story that the strange women turned his heart from the Lord. And Solomon failed miserably. And right outside of Jerusalem, right on the other side of the temple, he built houses to foreign gods. They're all there. And God said, no, I hate idolatry. You cannot go in to another god. And immorality is considered basically idolatry in God's eyesight. I was talking to someone not long ago, and this individual was saying, why can't we disobey God and act as if we were married? and enjoy life together. You're not under the legalistic Mosaic laws. Why can't we cast off all restraint? And that's what the world is telling us today. That we look at points in that direction. And I suggested, basically from a magazine that I received, and they had an article on there that said, men and women desire intimacy. Men desire it even more so than women. And the article said that in order to solve the problem between a male and a female, God has one plan. And that one plan is marriage. And we should seek God's, amen, approval in marriage. There's no light thing. When you go to the altar and say, I take thee to be my lawfully and wedded wife, to love and to behold until in sickness and in health, until death do us part. You need God's approval at that point. And though not trying to brag, but one of the blessings that has come to me over the past 45 years of our marital relationship is that I talk to the Lord and pray to God to send me a wife. And young ladies, you can pray to God and ask God to send you a husband. But now you've got to be right and pure in your own heart. And God does answer prayer. I met my wife at Bible school. Amen. You don't have an awful lot of them today. They've almost gone out of business. But I met her in Bible school. She was in Bible school when I met her. And though life hasn't been perfect, no, there have been times when perhaps you could call Sylvia and she would say, well, you know, I don't know about this thing. I don't mean that she's going to say I don't want to be married. But there are always struggles in life as we live for the Lord Jesus Christ. But the greatest blessing is to know that you've got God's choice for your life, for life. And so Solomon failed miserably. Let's go back, if you will, to the book of Ruth. I'm trying to chart the course that God is establishing a king that he's going to put on his throne. And this king will not sin. He will not make mistakes. This king will not be an immoral person. The book of Ruth, look at, if you will, chapter 1 again. This man by the name of Elimelech, found in verse 2. His name means, God is my king. That's what his name means. God is my king. It's a combination of two words here, meaning God and king. And although he professed the fact that God was his king, but he didn't act it out. You understand how we do so many times? The Lord is in charge of my life. I love the Lord. I'm walking with him when in fact we're walking in the flesh. And he was a man by the name of Elimelech. He led his family away from the house of bread. Anytime you go away from Bethlehem, that is the place where God feeds his people. Bethlehem was the city in which the Bible promised that the Messiah would be born there. You read it in Micah chapter 5 and verse 2. The Messiah is to be born in Bethlehem. But because of a situation that happened, you know, I'm unemployed, I don't have a job, I'm going to leave the place where God has fixed me, and I'm going to go over here into Moab and find some work, get some food. And that was Elimelech's thinking. When he said, God is my king, that was what his name meant. He really didn't live it out. And so he began to lean to his own understanding, and he thought that everything was wonderful in Moab. And he took his family and he went to Moab. And the way the text says it, basically, he didn't just go to Moab on vacation. When he moved from Bethlehem over to Moab, it was a permanent move. It was a transition that he made. I'm leaving the place where God has put me, the house of bread, in verse 1. Because of the famine, a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, and his wife and his two sons. He moved. It wasn't a visit. You get what I'm talking about? He moved from the place of bread, from the place where God was blessing his life. He moved and turned his back upon it and went to a place where God said, you shouldn't go into the land of Moab, because God promised Moses, remember, 38 years in the wilderness, I'm going to take you to the promised land. And they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, the Bible tells us. And then once they got there, Joshua allocated the land and gave them the places in Israel where they were to live. And God marvelously took care of them, supplied their every need in the land. The place of blessing. The house of bread. The place where I can rest with confidence in knowing God is blessing my life. He is in charge of my life. And so when Elimelech moved into Moab, what happened to him? We've kind of read the story. Elimelech passed away. His two sons, of course, married Moabitess women. But then his two sons passed away. And Naomi was left in a foreign land with foreigners all around her. And one young lady, of course, became loyal and devoted to Ruth. And that's how God brought this family together, to have someone to be the father of Obed, who was the father of Jesse, who was the father of David. So we sing the song, O Little Town of Bethlehem. So this is all written in the prophecy, where certain things had to have happened in Jesus' life. Number one, he had to have been born in Bethlehem. Why? Because the prophecy said so. Number two, he had to have been born of the virgin. Isaiah 7:14. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and be with child, and you'll call his name Emmanuel. He had to have been born of a virgin. And so many things we see in the text will tell us that Jesus Christ had to have been born as it was predicted in the prophecy of the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. See, he had to have been conceived by the Holy Spirit of God in Luke 1:35. The Holy Spirit will come up on Mary, and that holy thing that will be in her will be none other than the Son of the living God. That had to happen. And so it did, just as the Bible says. He had to have been a man, fully man, 100% man, and he had to have been God, 100% God. And here you have a baby that is born, that is all God, and a baby that is born, that is all man except the sinful nature. Christ had no sinful nature. John 1 and verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was who? God. He had to have been a complete man and a complete person as far as God is concerned. He had, as I said, to have been born in Bethlehem. Because Micah 5:2 said that's where he was going to be born. So the person I'm talking about this morning is not just some human being. This is God. God in a manger. God depended upon Mary and Joseph for food and bread. God in the flesh wrapped himself up and lived among us for 33 and a half years. And Herod had to bring a threat against him. And as a result of it, in Matthew 2:13, he had to go to Egypt in order to avoid the persecution that Herod had levied against all male children in his day, 2 years and under. That had to have happened. He went to Egypt, came out of Egypt, and was intending really to go back to Bethlehem, but no, the Spirit of God said, take the child and go on up to Nazareth. And they moved up to Nazareth because the Bible says he shall be called a Nazarene. He had to have grown up in Nazareth. Never made a mistake. He couldn't make a mistake because he was God. And he still is God. And all of those characteristics that are found in Isaiah chapter 11 and verse 1, the characteristics of the Holy Spirit of God, had to rest upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what I'm saying is this. My final point will be, and I'm not at my final point now, will be this. He had to have arisen from the dead. Peter preached a sermon on the temple steps in Acts chapter 2. And they were wondering what had happened after the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. And Peter stood on the temple steps talking to Jewish people. And he said, I want you to remember something that Psalms 116 says this, thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption. And Peter said to them, I'm telling you something. David's tomb is right over here. This is where David's bones are. But the greatest son of David is not there. He's arisen from the dead. As the Bible said, it was going to happen. Isn't that something? We worship the babe and we think about the babe in the manger. But listen, he is not the babe in the manger. He is the King who is reigning in heaven today. And you read the book of Matthew and you read the Gospels and you talk about the kingdom of the Lord. In John chapter 3, he said, except the man be born again, he cannot see what? The kingdom of God. But this new birth brings a whole new perspective in the hearts and lives of those who have trusted the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, we are concerned about how old we are. We won't always be here. But as long as the Holy Spirit of God is speaking to the hearts of men and women, the church will continue to move forward. It will not die out. No. As long as the Holy Spirit of God speaks to the heart of men and women. I know, I was 10 when God opened my heart. Had no idea that one day God would allow me to become a preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Just simply walking according to the will of God, searching the Bible, opening the Word of God, attending my church, being involved in my local body of believers in Christ. If you want me to teach, I'll teach. If you want me to help, I will help. I will do whatever I can. Why? Because I'm following the great King, and his name is Jesus, the greater son of David. The Lord Jesus said in Matthew 22, and got it in a note somewhere, but he asked the question, and I think I could ask the same question here this morning. What do you think of Jesus? Coming from Psalms 110. Whose son is Jesus? Well, if he's the son of David, well, how did David say, the Lord said to my Lord, sit on my right hand until I make your footstool. Yes, your enemy, your footstool. How did Jesus say that if he is the son of David? Oh, he's more than the son of David this morning. He's God. He's Lord. He is my Lord, and he is my King. And I am so thrilled today to know that I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew 22 and 44. Going back just a little bit. Jesus said in verse 40, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. While the Pharisees were gathered together in Matthew 22 and verse 41. Jesus asked them, saying, what do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? They said to him, the son of David. He said to them, how then does David in the Spirit call him Lord, saying, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. If David then calls